The information age gave us something truly incredible. The ability to communicate with anybody around the world instantly. But this privilege came at a great price. It gave people the opportunity to amplify their voices, often at the expense of their integrity. And it's all thanks to anonymity. All this type of communication required was being behind a screen, which made it quite easy to commit nefarious acts in an often untraceable, consequence-free environment. This problem would manifest itself in 1978 in the form of a message sent over ARPANET by a marketing manager named Gary Thurk. It was an ad for the Digital Equipment Corporation sent out to 400 people who didn't ask for it. Historians have since called this the very first spam email, though Gary prefers the term e-marketing, which is fair. But what exactly is spam? What makes it differ from other types of unsolicited messages? And how do we combat it? Thankfully, with the rapid advancement of technology, there has been an increase in cybersecurity. Antivirus programs are stronger than they've ever been, to the point where computer viruses, at least in the way that we understand them, have essentially become a thing of the past. But the same thing can't be said about spam, and it is where these two forms of malfeasance diverge. But despite several decades of community-based efforts to combat it, including many government initiatives, the spam problem seems to be only getting worse. And due to the rise of artificial intelligence, it is being magnified. By its very nature, spam is designed to be something that can't be stopped, and it appears to be a losing battle. So where exactly do we go from here? It all began in 1970, before personal computing was really even a thing. In fact, it started on television. The BBC was airing an episode of Monty Python's Flying Circus, which included a comedy sketch where two people enter a restaurant and everything on the menu has spam in it. And these poor customers are just being bombarded with spam, literally, even though one of them doesn't even like spam. Spam, spam, bacon, and spam. Now, why is this joke funny? Well, here's a bit of historical context. As you know, there was a lot of food rationing during World War II, especially with meat, which ended up in very short supply at that time. The one exception to this, well, spam, of course. In fact, there was plenty of spam to go around, so this became a bit of a staple food at the time, especially in Britain. And spam is just not a very exciting food. In fact, many people are terrified of even touching it with a 10-foot pole. And with so many people at the time constantly eating it, they quickly got sick of it. There was even an ongoing joke that spam was just ham that didn't pass the physical. So spam developed quite a negative reputation in the UK, which is where this Monty Python skit stems from. And over the next couple of decades, as personal computing entered the world and the internet started developing, this joke weirdly found a place within its culture. It basically became a meme in the late 80s and early 90s for online users to repeatedly post quotes from this skit during multi-user dungeon games. The whole purpose was to specifically be obnoxious and to irritate people. And so, spamming was born. In fact, this is also where the name for the programming language Python comes from. Of course, when Gary Thurk sent his advertisement back in 1978, it wasn't yet called spam, but the concept was still there, and it finally established a unique identity 20 years later, and only became more prominent as the internet gained its footing. It also evolved to fit many different definitions for what constitutes as spam. You have the original, popular variation of the word where people just post the same word or phrase repeatedly with the intention of irritating somebody, or something as simple as an unwanted advertisement that is sent to somebody one time. But as the internet grew and bad actors found exploits within computer security, a third variation of spam started to form, the kind that is specifically designed to harm people. And the way it does it is quite brilliant, because it often supersedes any kind of technological advancement, making it almost invincible. Hi kids, it's me, Steven. In today's day and age, we have been blessed with the privilege of easily communicating with one another all around the world instantly. all thanks to the computer. And so, we're going to look at all your lovely fan emails that you guys have sent me.
You've got mail.
Our first letter comes from Sage Montgomery of Clear Lake, Iowa. You have a great face for radio. Aw, not sure what that means, but thanks, Sage. Bobby Fisher from Mission Hills, California. Your videos used to be cool and mysterious, but now you're just very annoying. Okay. You can please some of the people, some of the time, and Viacom Incorporated. Unauthorized use of our intellectual property. What's Blue's Clues? Violation of your restraining order. It was 1 second I was throwing out my gum. It was fogging up the binoculars. Don't worry, kids. These are just spam emails. They can happen to anybody. Just gonna delete this and... presto!
You got mail.
Can it be? It's Bombas, today's sponsor. It's still the cozy season, so why not take advantage of it with Bombas' variety of socks, slippers, undergarments, and much more. I got myself some vintage striped calf socks and men's gripper slippers, and let me tell you, when I have these on, it's like I'm a whole new me, cozy and toasty. And if you're like me and accidentally spill lighter fluid all over your socks while doing a coal walk, thankfully Bombas has a 100% happiness guarantee and offers free returns and exchanges, even for damaged items. And of course, for every purchase you make, Bombas donates one of their top three items to people experiencing homelessness, and they have since made over 150 million donations. You can support that cause today by heading over to bombas.com/nationsquid or use code nationsquid at checkout to get 20% off your first purchase. Thank you to Bombas for sponsoring this video. Spam uses something called social engineering. Its efficiency relies on appealing to the victim's emotions and wants in a dishonest way, which inadvertently invites them in to orchestrate their desired attack. Now, computer viruses and malware do this as well, but they also operate on a much more objective, technical level than spam does, which makes it easier to combat. Spam, on the other hand, pretty much only relies on human emotion. In other words, the malware is the thing that causes the physical damage, and the spam is the method of delivery for that malware. I understand that this is more of a semantic argument than anything, but this distinction is important to make if we are to fully understand why the spam problem seems to be growing. Here is an example that is, unfortunately, happening a lot right now on YouTube. You may have noticed that a lot of your favorite channels have been getting hacked and having their entire channels replaced with these weird crypto Tesla-related videos. Much of it is even AI-generated. These videos often include deepfakes of celebrities promoting a product or a service, aka the malware that's pretending to be said product or service. And of course, that is how the malware spreads. But you're probably wondering how these YouTube channels even get hacked in the first place. Again, it isn't even as technical as it is emotional. Several notable tech channels have also fallen victim to this scam. They do it by pretending to be YouTube sponsorships. What do YouTubers love more than anything? Money. And what is the most enticing thing that they can hear? That there is an incredible business opportunity for them. They usually claim to be a sponsorship agency acting on behalf of a fake company, or sometimes even a real company. But of course, it's all fake. They will then tell you to provide all your contact and payment information in the file that they've attached for you so that you can properly get paid for the sponsor. But this file actually contains a script that secretly activates when you open it. This is usually a keylogger, which tracks your keys as you type, allowing for the malware developer to see what you're typing and therefore find out your password. Sometimes this script searches for a particular cookie on your computer that is completely responsible for remembering all your login permissions that keep you logged into your Google account automatically. This is called a session cookie hijack attack. What's even scarier about these is that they are even able to bypass two-factor authentication. And so, the perpetrator now has full access to your account and can do what they please. Now, most of the time, these emails are obvious giveaways. They contain misspellings, unprofessional formatting, and often come from strange email addresses. I even got one from John Lennon. Never thought this was how we'd meet. As fake as these emails look when I explain them to you, picture yourself as a YouTube channel who is just really yearning to make some good money and can't wait. Or maybe it's your first time doing a sponsorship and you don't know what the customs or standard industry practices are for something like that. So you go against your gut and download the file anyway. It happens much more than you think. A lot of these bigger channels have interns working for them that are responsible for putting these deals together, and sometimes they make a mistake. But notice how, when the YouTube viewer is the target, the setup is a little different. Because of these AI-doctored videos, the viewer will think that someone they perhaps look up to is promoting a certain product or some kind of opportunity to make money. And these deepfakes are convincing, so there's no way it can be fake, so they'll go ahead and download it themselves. The malware is the same, but there's two different types of spam, one for the content creator and one for the viewer. This is a big problem on YouTube right now, and hopefully they will fix it soon. But even if they do, the spam is not going away. Instead, it'll just take on a new form and contain a whole new virus. But the fact remains, it's still an unwanted, unsolicited message with the same objective. And in that respect, it hasn't changed at all. And that's something much more difficult to fight, because a virus often has a very predictable structure at its foundation that operating systems are now smart enough to filter out. This is why crazy malware like the love letter worm from 2000 isn't exactly popping up all the time these days. But with spam, it's much harder to police language, at least with this type of approach. Sure, you can filter out certain keywords to prevent a particular type of spam from popping up, but the spammer can always find another way of communicating the same message without using that keyword. The possibilities are practically endless. Finding a completely new way to write the same type of virus that bypasses these antivirus filters? Not impossible, but so much more complicated, and therefore not nearly as common. Now, with AI, this has only been getting worse. Not only are they good at working around certain keywords, they can now detect nuance and emulate very niche, specific ways of communicating that would otherwise not be possible without AI. Going back to the fake sponsorships examples, I actually almost fell for one of these for this exact reason. I got what looked like a normal, professional-looking email that appeared to come from a legitimate .com address. I responded to the message asking for more details regarding the deal, and sure enough, they wrote back. Or should I say, it wrote back. And it was responding to certain things that I said in a way that made sense. The only reason I didn't fall for it was because I got a response almost immediately after I hit send. And that's when I noticed it kind of had that ChatGPT style of writing that's overly polished. My agent was then able to confirm that this was in fact not a real company. But had they timed that response better? Who knows what could have happened? Another big reason for why spam continues to go strong is, of course, because it is much more profitable than, say, malware is. A lot of the overly destructive programs that we typically think of when we think of computer viruses, like the ones from the 90s and early 2000s, were primarily designed with just destruction in mind. They just wanted to watch the world burn. Spam, on the other hand, is often very profitable and costs very little to put out. As economists Justin Rao and David Riley put it, it is a negative externality that cannot be described as a form of pollution. The scammer is making money from it, but everyone else is paying for it, both through time and money. If you remember my video about the 1-800 golf tip mystery, I briefly talk about the practice of phantom calling, and this operates in a pretty similar way. It is designed to make the perpetrator a huge profit while simultaneously pushing the burden of the infrastructure costs over to the phone companies. This is the negative externality. This research paper by Alexandra Samuel does a great job with breaking this all down, specifically in the context of spam emails. Even if the vast majority of people nowadays know better than to fall for these spam messages, that doesn't matter. One scammer was able to create something called a botnet, which allowed them to send over 1.5 billion emails a day, distributing across tons of computers. Not only does this make the source of the spam harder to track, but it once again shifts the burden of cost to someone else. Even if the conversion rate of these spam messages was 0.00001%, if you were to send out 8.7 billion emails with these botnets, that would still be 8,760 people who fell for the scam. And if each transaction was $50, that would be $438,000 in revenue, a figure that they could generate in about a week. With many different types of spam tailored to different audiences, improving technologies that make it more convincing, and financial incentives driving its spread, it makes perfect sense that spam is more present than ever, despite the increases in cybersecurity. Spam will never go away, no matter how much you try. It is specifically designed that way, and categorizing something as spam can be almost subjective. As Rao and Riley themselves stated, estimating the amount of spam that beats spam filters is difficult. After all, if we knew it was spam, we would have filtered it. But that doesn't mean that we should lose all hope. The best way to combat spam is to simply become more aware of it. Just like how we encourage teaching people computer literacy, perhaps it's now time to teach artificial intelligence literacy and how to quickly spot the distinct behaviors it exhibits, the kinds of behaviors we often overlook at face value. In this way, it is our responsibility to look out for potential dangers and take the proper precautions to avoid them. This includes asking questions, double-checking where messages come from, confirming that the person you are talking to is trustworthy before giving them any kind of personal information. The list goes on and on. We can't worry about the things that are beyond our control, at least not in the way where it debilitates our ability to live. You can certainly do your part in serving others, but you are the only person that you have 100% control over. The world may never rid itself of spam messages, but you, as an individual, certainly can. I will be doing an upcoming video about the evolution of computer viruses, so stay tuned for that. But if you'd like to learn more about one of my favorite malware stories, you can find my video on that here. A special thanks to all my Patreon supporters, patreon.com/nationsquid. You can also buy me a coffee. Thank you for watching, everybody.